know my name. You know racing cars is my favorite game, and you know I can't be beat when I'm in the driver's seat. See, I got a lead foot and gas in my veins. God put a V8 where he should have put brains. There ain't a race I haven't run. There ain't a race I haven't won. And it's been 7 days since I've won a race, and I don't plan on leaving this place till I've won another. Said you cry at home to your mother. See, I got the car, the skill, the crew, the will. God hates a sinner, but he loves a winner. You dare to show your face? Come on, Ace. Let's race. On the field and I'm sitting on the pole. Pace car's gone, the green flag drops, 500 miles to go. Let's race.
24 car, left hand side. Go low, go low, you come off. You got him. 17 car, taking a high road.
Hello again, everybody. This is Joe Larson. You're watching the 505 on Racing Show. Welcome. Hope everybody had a nice holiday, Easter, Passover, whatever you celebrate in your family and your world. I know I had an okay one myself. It was good. The best is I didn't have to work, but I did have to work last Monday. You know, it's kind of funny. You know, you're sitting there and you get to a point of no return where you know you're not going to make it to the show. And I wasn't making it to the show from where I was, so I apologize. For those of you who were logged in, ready to rock and roll and talk racing, sorry I ruined your night. But what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Yeah, I got the world news set tonight. You know, we have over here, I guess, what do we got over here? We got some country over here. We got a country right behind me. So, this one over here, it's like North America, and then we got South America, we got Africa over here. So I know some of my geography. Some of it, but it's good. It's good. We try to make things, you know, we try to change things up every once in a while. So I feel like, you know, like, I don't know, for those of you who remember, and I know W did this, like Chet Huntley, you know, you know, Roger Grimsby hitting out of news, you know, that's what I feel like today. But anyway, it's all good. Long Island is, now if I use the right hand here, Long Island is up here somewhere, I think. I think it's over here somewhere. Somewhere over there. It kind of juts out of New York, and it's a river that separates it from New Jersey. And then there's they call it a sound. The Long Island Sound separates it from Connecticut and Rhode Island. So, WJ, don't waste stuff. You know, I know myself. I had fun with those things. Anyway, not a lot going on in the NASCAR world this past weekend. Now, this past week has been very quiet since Fontana. And where the WrestleMania kind of broke out. And I'll tell you what, I was all set. I had a whole big thing to talk about last week about that event. But I don't know what Tony Stewart was upset about. And I'll tell you what, and for those who know me and know me a long time, you know, I was like him. I get in somebody's way and then get shoved, and then I go screaming, you know, what'd you do to me? And that's just, I don't. Good hard racing. There's nothing wrong with that. And you know, what happened at the end though with Denny Hamlin and Joey Logano, I know NASCAR says, boys, have at it. But you know what? I hit a wall where my car did almost the same thing, because when it hit, the back end of the car lifted and slammed me down, and I broke my back too. I didn't break L1, I broke the coccyx and actually crushed it. And whatever way it's supposed to be curved, mine curves the other way now. And if I sit too long, like for 2 hours, it's difficult to stand. And if I stand too long, it's difficult to sit. So I sympathize with Denny Hamlin, and I offer, you know, wish him a speedy recovery. You know, in the meantime, Joe Gibbs Racing has put Mark Martin in the car. Hamlin's going to be out. They're saying 6 weeks. I don't know. I'm not a doctor, but Dr. Jerry Petty said of the Carolina Neurosurgery and Spine Association says Denny's going to be out 6 weeks. So, with that being said, Mark Martin is going to hop in and try to make it happen, from at least keep the owner points. And You know, WJ, I was thinking the same thing. Here's Elliott Seidler, who's just right on the edge of getting a cup right again. And why not put him in the car? Why not put him? And maybe part of that is, you know, Mark Martin is really part of Michael Waltrip Racing, and they drive Toyotas. And Toyota got in and made this happen. The politics of NASCAR, you'll never understand. Because that does happen. You know, NASCAR does dictate. And maybe let me back up. NASCAR and key sponsors kind of talk together as to what they want to do. Because, as I was once told, all we do here is put on a show. And I mean here at NRadio, but at the racetrack in NASCAR. All we do is put on a show. And they really don't care who wins, who loses, as long as when the fans leave, it was a good show. Is it always a good show? I don't think so. But as WJ is saying, Coach Joe doesn't think he's ready. But Sadler drove a Toyota for Gibbs and Nationwide. See, you're right. That's why I'm thinking that this decision came from somewhere else. It didn't come. Joe Gibbs didn't sit in the boardroom with JD and say, let's do this. Just my opinion. I'm just saying. But it's just interesting what goes on here. And I've met Mark Martin in person. I don't want to say I know Mark Martin. If I ran into him at sporting goods store or at the parcel store, I wouldn't go up to say, Mark, how's everything? How was your Easter? But I do know Mark, and had the opportunity to spend some time with him at Pocono last season when we had that thunderstorm race where people got struck by lightning. And kind of a funny guy. I mean, he's an old school racer, but you know, he was talking to a bunch of us. We were guests of Sprint, and he was talking to the group, and he said that he wasn't going to sign any autographs because he didn't have time. And I understand. I respect that. And he said, so if I can't do everybody's autograph, I'm not going to do any. No. I don't know. Here's a guy that's been in the sport forever, and many of the people that were in that suite with me that day. Well, from my age, back when, you know, Mark Martin was struggling and made the hit with Valvoline when he was driving the six car. And, you know, some of these guys forget where they came from. I'm willing to bet my last dollar if Richard Petty was in that suite, not only would he have signed every autograph, but whoever he couldn't get to because he had to go do another engagement, he would have came back and did later. And I've seen that firsthand. I've been at Lee Petty's compound, and I can remember people lined up in Randleman, in Level Cross, and just lined up in Level Cross. And Richard Petty did not leave his father's porch until everybody had what they wanted signed. So, and I forgot that, though, WJ. Yes, Stroh's Beer was his first sponsor before he had Valvoline. So, you kind of wonder, in certain sports, even. And I'm going to go off on a little baseball tangent. Now, baseball started today here in New York. Yankees and the Mets both opened at home. What were the schedule makers thinking? But when I went to my first Mets game in 1968, I remember all the Mets players lined up on the where the box seats are by the dugout. Lined up, everyone had a little section, and people lined up and got autographs. And it wasn't a special night where it was like first 15,000 fans get. Everybody was there up until a certain time could get autographs, and you could run from line to line. And somewhere in my archives of junk that I have, I probably still have that booklet that I had the Mets sign. I remember, Tommy Agee signing, Johnny Callison, he played for the Phillies. The things that you remember, played for the Phillies. He was there, and he actually came over and signed. But I don't know. Some of these race car drivers today just don't want to be bothered with the fans, and I don't know. I just don't know. And what is it? Just saw a few bombs go off in real ways. Oh man, that's bad. Watch your head. Yeah, watch my head. Maybe do me a favor. But anyway, I just don't understand today's race car driver in that level. I know when NASCAR went to the hot pass system in the garage area, it used to be if you were lucky enough to score a garage pass, you were in. And what happened was the newer breed race car driver, crew chiefs or whoever petitioned NASCAR to do this, they made it so the garage was what they called hot, where only select people could be in the garage, as opposed to cold. And cold meant you can go in the garage, but there weren't too many race car drivers walking around. And I forget which race car drivers that one of the drivers said at the time when they were stating their argument. They said, I don't go to your job and bother you where you're racing. Don't come to my job and bother me when I'm trying to do my job. Well, you know what? I have to say, well, if it wasn't for the people walking around in a pit area and sitting in the grandstand, that driver wouldn't have a job. And they forget that. That's, you know. And that's part of it, too. I don't disagree with you, WJ, that the tracks were selling too many passes. But, you know, between the track and NASCAR, I was bumped one year. I had all set hot passes. I'm going down to Daytona. My boss, you know, NASCAR, you know, hooked me up, and I'm going. And a couple of days before the event, he told me, listen, I had to downgrade your pass. And I said, would you give me a cold pass? He goes, no, I gave you a hot pass, but it's for the Nationwide Series, which I think was still the Busch Series back then. That's how long ago it was. And I didn't think any damn of it. I'm still in until Sunday when I was nobody, and I couldn't even get through the tunnel to get to the infield. You know, but I know when I had a sign for my, they call it a single event license for Daytona, it was like $475 if you wanted to buy it. I don't buy it, obviously. I get it, hand it to me, and I go to any track in this country as a NASCAR employee / guest, with the exception of one. But every other track in the country, I can just call up, I'm coming, and I'm on the VIP list. So kind of interesting. But getting back to these drivers of today, they don't remember where they came from. Some of these guys and gals raced their local short tracks. I mean, they didn't just wake up one day, go to school, graduate, and say, oh, I'm going to be a Sprint Cup driver. A lot of these drivers came from other series and weekly tracks and maybe the IndyCar League, but they all came from somewhere, go-karts, sprint cars, you know, Indy cars, Indy lights. I mean, they all came, the diverse backgrounds in auto racing. And now, you know, now here they are, you know. I don't know, you know. But it's kind of upsetting when you hear stuff like that. You know, WJ had a hot pass in Martinsville 3 years ago when he covered that race. Yes, you did, and it was a pleasure seeing you. They had a good time, you know. It was kind of funny, WJ, if I remember correctly. That hot pass gave you like all access, you know, and not that, you know, when you look at Martinsville, it's just a little bit bigger than a half mile. I think it's I don't know, like 0.533 or something, or 521. It's just a little bit bigger than a half mile, and it's when you lay it out and you figure it out, it's probably almost, well, it is as big as, maybe it's a little bit smaller than Thompson Speedway in Connecticut, and everything's in the infield, and when you put, you know, 43 haulers for the Cup Series, and then whatever the support division is that day, and usually the Truck Series, they brought, you know, if you've ever watched that happen, the way they line up these haulers, and first they get them in line out in the field, out in the street. Because you line up, you come in points order. Point leader gets the first spot and right down the line. They line up in points order. It makes it easy to find the teams when you're an official. Right? Where's so-and-so? Well, he's fourth in points. He's the fourth hauler. You just go find him. Whereas some series, like mine, you get online and the big haulers on one side, the shorties on the other side. And then you got to go figure out where they are. And I used to make a list of what order they were in, and I just, you know, it was easier to just go find them. But, you know, but watching, even when we went to Bristol, it was just amazing. I mean, everybody got in easy, but getting out when they had to be, you know, pulled out with a payloader, with a chain, and because it's just going up that bank and that turn there to get out is quite difficult. Oh, yeah, that's right. You know what's funny? I've been to Martinsville probably 20 or 30 times. And they all blend. Every event is a blend. And yesterday the trucks were there that weekend and got rained out on Saturday, and they raced on Monday, which you know it's good that they got the race in, but you know, you don't get your money back if they race on Monday. And not that Martinsville is an expensive place to go when to buy tickets, but when you know you got to get home and you got to catch a plane Monday, there's nothing you can do. There's nothing you can do. And I even used to take the latest flight home Monday, because one year that happened to me, and we were leaving. We had a flight at midday and couldn't stay for the race, and it made for a not too pretty ride home. You know, a flight home, I should say, because, you know, I should have known that we should have booked a later flight to get out, and I never made that mistake again. But it's one of those things. You know, weather, it's an outdoor sport. You can't race in the rain. Nobody's going to be sitting in the stands. And you know, but when you race on Monday and everybody's gone, the track already has its money. So they put the race on. And I would say, as a competitor, racing to an empty house and isn't that can't be too exciting for them. And racing, you know, through the television cameras, that's, you know, nobody's really watching it on TV anyway, because most of us are traveling home or at work. So, you know, I know scheduling is tough, especially when you race every week, but it really should take a look at rainouts. And I think that's what we're going to talk about when we come back, and we'll be back.
Rich's Bay Diner and Restaurant. Steaks, chops, wraps, breakfast skillets. The Mauritius Bay, 62 Montauk Highway in Mauritius, New York. 878-6827. The Mauritius Bay Diner and Restaurant in New York.
Hey, this is Joe Larson from the 5-4-5 On Racing Show, and you are watching InRadio.com, broadcasting to the world.
InRadio.com.
The future of radio is now. InRadio.com. Broadcasting to 6.8 billion people. Internet, radio, TV.
We're back. So scheduling and rainouts, and you know, it's. I can remember a modified tour race on Long Island way back. I mean, way back. My kids were tiny, tiny. In fact, Megan and Joe weren't even born yet, if I'm not mistaken. And I can remember the modified tour race was here on Long Island on a Wednesday, and it rained. So they're going to race Thursday, and it rained. And the race Friday, and it rained. And I can remember one of the rainout nights, the announcing staff was asking people, announcing, if you have room in your house, these drivers and teams can't afford to stay in the hotels, and some of them can't get rooms because they're having, you know, they were booked and they only had their room for a certain day, and you know, blah, 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 and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I can remember them asking to do that and make it happen, let them stay a little longer. You know, and people let the team stay at the houses. It was kind of funny. Because, you know, race fans are different. One of my customers was talking to me the other day about racing. In fact, no, it wasn't a customer. It was an employee at one of my stores. And I remember talking about it, and he said that, you know, race fans, you don't even have to know the person's name. You don't even have to know where they're from. But if you have a racing shirt, jacket, hat, and you have a situation or a problem, another race fan is going to help you out. So it's just the way it is. And race people are, like I said, they're a loyal bunch of people, and they're a loyal bunch of people, and they want to help each other. And don't usually, I don't know what I did. All I did was touch my mic. I don't know. But We'll see if we can get that cleared up for you. But it's the weather. The weather's a tough thing. And I, you know, years ago, I can remember the season on Long Island started in early April. Usually, like right after the holiday season with the Passover and Easter. And then I can remember it ending in October. And again, you know, we've talked about that, but we raced every weekend for the most part. And we went, and when you had rainouts, you know, you had a 22-week schedule, and this is at the weekly level. And if you had rain, right, so you lost a night. Sometimes that was good for you. You know, it gave you a chance to regroup, get your car back together, you know. And now it's some of the schedules, and I've seen schedules at the racetracks, and there's some racetracks that don't race every week. They race every other week. So you have, you know, from April to October, April to September, you got 20 weeks, and you're racing every other week. That's 10 weeks. Throw a rain out in there or two, and you know, now you raced 8 times. And some of these track motors wonder why they don't have a car count. And it's a lot of places, and a lot of people blame the economy. You know, I'll tell you what, I know a race car driver, and I'm not gonna say the guy's or the gal's name, but I know a race car driver who is in dire straits financially. So I said, well, so what are you gonna do? You gonna sit the season out? Maybe race a handful of races? Oh no, I'm going to my engine builder next week, I'm gonna pick up my motor. Now wait a minute, hold it. You're getting ready to lose your house. You have no food in your refrigerator, but you're going to get your motor from the engine builder. Oh, and then there's another person who says, you know, another guy that he doesn't have anything, but he has his race car, and he's sitting there worrying about a fancy paint job and a bumper. What's, you know, the priorities. Some race car drivers aren't that bright when it comes to finances. And you know, you want to go racing, and then you start dipping into your household fund, you can't pay your bills, and you're hoping that you make enough Saturday to put the money back that you misused, so to speak, I guess, for lack of a better term. And when you do that, you know, that's a never-ending spiral or downward spiral. You just don't get it. You never catch up. You never catch on, and but you go racing. You know, like Ned Jarrett, when he bought his first race car, he bought it like on a Friday night. He gave the guy a check, and he had to do well enough on Saturday so he could put the money in the bank on Monday so the check would clear. And fortunately enough for him, he did. And he was able to do it, but he's just one of thousands that would sell their wives or their husband's jewelry to go racing. It's just one of those things. I know. Again, I've been fortunate enough where I haven't had to do that ever, to go racing, and that's only because I approach racing a little bit different. I know TK Tomcraft and I, we had a conversation a few months back about racing and sponsors and what we do and how we did it, and he was good. You know, he knew he was more often than not a podium finish. 1, 2, 3 over the scales, you're good. Go to the payoff window and collect your money, and especially in the figure eight division here on Long Island, which is a darn good paying race division, if I do just say so myself. And He had some sponsorship back in the day. A lot of it was, and from what I understood, enough to get the car built, which is big. You know, you got your chassis, your frame, your stuff, your motor, your whatever. But he didn't have that weekly sponsor, to my knowledge, anyway. But he didn't need it because he was winning races and finishing first, second, and third for the most part. And I approached racing a little bit different. I drew the sponsor out, and I was middle of the pack to the back at best. But I think when we looked at what was in my bank account of the race car, when what TK had. I had money at the end of the year. But he had a lot of hardware that showed that he was won all these races and won championships. And I was just, I treated it like a business, and he treated it like a sport. The sport that, that maybe some of the folks, you know, want it to be and have a good time doing. But to me, I approached it as a business. I always did, and I don't know. And Mr. Slice, welcome. You don't have to apologize to us for being late here. That's all that matters. Because I think you were late once, and I was late probably in 2 years, probably 100 times. So welcome. Good to see you. I see that Jay Slice, crew chief for his brother Brian, putting together a figure eight car. And I saw some pictures. I don't know if I'm allowed to say that, but I saw some pictures of the car. And it looks like it's coming along good, and I hope they make it out in time for at least opening day. They might, from what it sounds like, they may miss practice, but, you know, as one of my drivers once said to me, if practice makes perfect and nobody's perfect, why practice? Yeah, anyway, but I wish those guys well. They work hard, and, you know, this off season has hurt them. But anyway, but it's all good. So weather. Now, the weather lately, like when I drove here today, tonight, out to the studio, the weather here on Long Island was horrible. It was raining quite heavily, but only in spots. There was spots when I left the house that was nice, and there was spots that was downpour. And people are saying they can't hear me. I could talk a little bit louder, but I don't know if that would work. Move this thing again. See, maybe if that helps. So if that's better, let me know, guys. Yeah, so Mr. Slice can hear me. Thank you, Mr. Slice. Jay Slice. WJ has no difference. Wow. I don't know. You know what we might have to do is we might just have to have WJ down here a couple of nights a month as like a guest co-host, and they could hear it all live. And then I think that would be a good thing. In fact, I'm putting that out there to WJ from iRaceNews.com, who supports this show and many of the other shows here at In Radio very, very well. So, I don't know. So Jay Slice got a lot done on their car, so it's a good thing. But anyway, moving forward, the modifieds. NASCAR Wheeling Southern Modified Tour will be at South Boston in 2 weeks, April 13th. And the NASCAR Wheeling Modified Tour will open up at Thompson, Connecticut for the traditional icebreaker. And then the K&N Pro Series East will be at Greenville Pickens this weekend. And the K&N Pro Series West is off until May 4th, where they travel to Stockton 99 Speedway in Stockton, California. Now, I had heard... I saw at the NASCARjobs.com that the K&M Pro Series West is still looking for a series director with the departure of the past series director, Yeoman Carey, who left to pursue other things. And you know, a couple of folks said that maybe I should put in for that. Now, I'm looking at their schedule, and they're in Iowa, they're in Washington State, they're in California. I'm like, you know, NASCAR don't want to send me to Charlotte because it's far, so I'm not thinking they're going to send me to the West Coast. But, you know, it's funny how things develop. Maybe a couple of years ago I would have jumped at that opportunity, but things are a little bit different now, so I don't know. You know, there's a lot of balls being juggled in the JTL Enterprise Motorsports camp, and I don't know what I still don't know what 2013 is going to bring for the entirety of the season. I do know I'll be at Thompson and Stafford, and probably Monadnock. After that, I'm not really sure. So Slice is talking about going to be ready for opening night. It's a 50-50 shot, and it's going to depend on how the weather goes on Saturdays. And that's a tough thing. That's, you know, these guys, they work outside, and it's tough. And if it's raining, it's tough to work in the rain. you know. So according to myracenews.com and the unofficial weather report, it's going to be 53 and sunny this Saturday. So they need to kick in the butt and make it happen. So anyway. So looking at Thompson. NASCAR will modify tour will be at Thompson April 14th. And for that weekend, and I'm really concerned about a car count. I mean, terribly concerned about a car count. First race of the year, usually brought in 45 to 55 race cars in the past, that to the point where we would spend all day Friday getting there early in the morning and starting our tech on Friday. If the cars are there, we tech them, which made our Saturday a little bit easier. But we're not doing that this year from what I could see. And I'd be surprised if we have 25 cars. 25 cars at the icebreaker for the NASCAR Wheel and Modified Tour is it's not good. And, you know, and people are looking to point the blame. It's his fault. It's NASCAR's fault. It's the track fault. It's the car owner's fault. It's the sponsor. Everybody wants to point the blame. It's one of those things where you can't blame any single entity. You can't. In my opinion, we all know what my opinion is worth, but I don't feel you can blame it. I think it's a multitude of things. I think a lot of the money has dried up. I think a lot of the, when I say money, the sponsorship money has dried up. I think a lot of the older competitors are just hanging on with the equipment they have. They haven't built or bought a new car in a long time. They're doing freshen ups on motors instead of, you know, getting new ones. I don't know. The racetracks, that, you know, their cost to operate has changed drastically, and you know, it's just a vicious cycle. You know, this past off season has hurt a lot of teams, a lot of businesses, and. What happens with that is the money isn't there. There's businesses that were here at Thanksgiving that aren't here anymore because they got wiped out. They got put out of business. The storm. Some people still aren't in their houses here on Long Island. You know, from that storm, that they're still trying to get the monies to put it back together. You know, I don't know. It's just one of those things, and you know, when you look at that, you know, where do you cut from? I'm a business. Let's say I have a business, and every year I give XYZ racing team $20,000, but between the snow and Superstorm Sandy, I had a lot of damage. I had a lot of snow plowing cost. What do I do? Where does that money come from? I have to cut somewhere. So where am I going to cut? I got to cut from my advertising budget. I don't agree with that. I think that's wrong. I really do. I think that's wrong. I think many of the people or the businesses that get the word out. Hey, I'm still in business and I'm ready to serve you. You know, but that doesn't happen. You know, sometimes you got these people sitting in the boardroom and they don't want to dig in. You know, you don't want to dig in. And I see there's a little bantering here in the chat room about, you know, somebody's car being ready, and I know that's the car that Jay Slice belongs to or associates with, and it's tough, you know. You know, the division, the figure eight division here in Long Island, I was at a meeting last week and a week before, and they were doing the traditional March meeting, car count meeting. And they sit there, you know, they get make a list, and they, you know, hey, well, we're going to have 16 cars, we're going to have 15 cars. Last year at that meeting, I said there's going to be nine cars. Everybody said I was negative, I was this, that, the other thing. Made references to my sister, you know, because I don't know what I'm talking about. Well, they had nine cars. Sometimes they had 10. So at this meeting, at the last one, they're back with the same 12, 14, who has two cars, who's this, who's that, who's the other thing, and blah, blah, blah. And this guy's sitting, but you know, we're going to put this guy in there, and it's going to be the car shuffle, you know, just to get the cars out there. We're going to put, you know, guys who never raced in cars, just so there's a good car count. Well, here's the number. It's in the archives. The number is 8. They're going to average 8 cars. I'm not happy about that. I'm an old figure eight guy through and through my whole life. But, you know, and like somebody, you know, Jay's saying 10 if they can make it. If they can't make it, 11 if they can. I don't know if we're going to have that many open a day. I hope so. I hope there's not 80 like when I was a kid trying to qualify and starting 33rd in the country when he took 2. But it's just not the same. And it's a catch 22. Part of it is the schedule is a nightmare. But from the promoter's side, and I got to side with them. Do you want to put on a show with 8 cars or 9 cars or 10 cars where 3 drop out on lap 2 and then it just kind of crisscross? It looks like a warm-up. It looks like a practice. The fans don't want to see that. The fans want to see good hard racing. You know, I don't know. You know, Jay Slice is a 9 already. 9 figure eight cars are ready to go. Andrew Donaldson VW to the field. And Tommy Rogers, a multi-time champion in figure eight everything. Young guy, he's driving in the modifieds now. It's all good. And again, I hope that happens. And speaking of the figure eight guys, this upcoming Sunday, April 7th at the Smithtown Landing Country Club is the annual SAFER Awards Banquet. I believe this is the 45th annual SAFER Awards Banquet, where they crown their champion, give out their special awards, get some Hall of Fame inductees in. And speaking of Hall of Fame inductees, maybe when we come back from a little break, we'll talk about, because it looks like there's basically Long Island is on here tonight. We could talk about who they feel should be in the SAFER Hall of Fame that is not already. Because it seems to be a big discussion, and there's a little committee that talks about that and decides who's going to be in the Hall of Fame. And you know, a lot of people outside of figure eight racing think it's a silly, stupid little club where you get to maybe you talk about tires and schedules and things you can't control. And they're not wrong. However, you know, figure eight racing has been around for over 50 years here on Long Island that I recall. And to be in the Figure Eight Hall of Fame, it's just like being in, to a Figure Eight guy, it's like being in the Hockey Hall of Fame for a hockey player, the Baseball Hall of Fame for a baseball player, and so forth and so on. Your peers recognized something that you did over the years, and we had a conversation. I had a conversation with a couple of guys, and they were telling me that we're running out of guys to put into the Hall of Fame. And when I look at that, I say, well, you go back to the ISIS Speedway days. Is every ISIS Speedway champion in the Hall of Fame? Yeah. As guys of the top 10 in wins that aren't active anymore, well, they in the Hall of Fame, most of them. And I think for the most part they are. I think, I know Mr. TK listens to the show. I know he doesn't go in a chat room, and maybe somebody at his house could go in and let me know if the top 10 in wins, but I believe they are. Maybe there's one that's not. But you know, and now, so what's left? There's some car owners, there's some officials that are in. There's even some sponsors, race sponsors that are in there. They never race figure eight cars, but they were very helpful to the figure eight division and some engine builders and so forth. So now what's left is the old time Riverhead figure eight guys. And I'm talking guys like Danny Turbish, Dan Giovanelli, Greg Sachs, know, those guys, in my opinion, they deserve to be in this figure eight Hall of Fame. You know, there's some others. As Jay Slay says, it's a good club to have if you need help on getting items. Everyone helps each other out, and that is so true. It's so true. Because that's what it's all about. I mean, they may be beating and banging on the racetrack. They may be yelling and screaming in the pit area. But you go to the safe meeting, and you have a beer, you have a soda, you have whatever. Some guys have a cup of coffee, whatever they have. You sit down and you talk. I can remember some safe meetings, Roger Maynard bringing his DVD player and putting the tape in and talking to guys and talking to newbies and rookies and showing them, you know, maybe, hey, you did this wrong, you did this right, et cetera, et cetera. Or two guys arguing about what they did to each other, and you put the video in or the DVR in or the DVD. And DVR, you know, there's so many initials in, so many acronyms. And you look at, hey, what happened here? What really happened? Because the video don't lie. So anyway, we're going to take a break. When we come back, I'm going to talk some more figure eight stuff with you guys and gals.
Good Times Magazine, New York's best entertainment paper for 43 years. Check out their calendar for all the latest music info, including New York City, Queens, Nassau, and Suffolk. Studio News brings you the biggest news about the hottest artists and sounds. Technobeat is your guide to electronica, techno, house, and dubstep. PackTrack keeps you up to date on the biggest events at the area's performing arts centers and theaters. Good Times Magazine gives you all this and more. It's bi-weekly, and it's free. Pick up your copy today or visit goodtimesmag.com.
Well, here comes a woman with a look in her eye. She's dressed on leather and flesh on the mind. Words and weapons sharpen the knives. Makes you wonder how the other half died. A devil inside, the devil inside. Every single one of us, the devil inside. The devil inside, the devil inside. Every single one of us, the devil inside. The devil inside, the devil inside. Every single one of us, the devil inside. Devil inside, devil inside. Every single one of us, the devil inside.
Times Magazine, New York's best entertainment paper for 43 years. Check out their calendar for all the latest music info, including New York City, Queens, Nassau, and Suffolk. Studio News brings you the biggest news about the hottest artists and sounds. Technobeat is your guide to electronica, techno, house, and dubstep. Packtrack keeps you up to date on the biggest events at the area's performing arts centers and theaters. Good Times Magazine gives you all this and more. It's bi-weekly, and it's free. Pick up your copy today or visit goodtimesmag.com.
InRavio.com.
East End Screen Printing and Embroidery. Shirts for as low as $3 with print. 631-281-TEES. That's 631-281-TEES. 1355F Montauk Highway, Mastic, Long Island, New York. Go to eastendsilkscreenprinting.com for more info.
And we're back. Hopefully, my sound's a little bit better. Hopefully. So, you know, Safer Hall of Fame, named after Ernie Maina, the late, great Ernie Maina, who lost his life at Isis Speedway, I believe in 1982, figure eight racing. And they named this Hall of Fame in his honor. So it's been a lot of years, 80, 90, you know, 30 years. It's been the Ernie Maina Memorial Hall of Fame. Now, there's a lot of people in this Hall of Fame, a lot of people. And I'll tell you what, each and every individual that's been there that deserves to be in there. I can't look at one name on that list, and I don't have my list here with me because I didn't plan on talking about the Hall of Fame. But every person on that deserves to be in for one reason or another, whether they were a good competitor. And when I say good, they won races, they won championships. They helped other people. A behind-the-scenes guy, and a name that comes to name, Rick Swanson, crew chief for TK Tom Craft forever. And I remember when Ricky was racing the red number two, the 56 Ford that he ran at ISIF in the mid-70s, and then chopped the cage down, shortened the car up a little bit, and put a Mustang body on it, and continued racing figure eights, but continued helping other people at the same time. A car which I drove his Mustang. In fact, I drove his Mustang, I'm going to say 1980, 1981, a long time ago. But when you look at that, when you look at, you know, the prestige of being in that Hall of Fame, you know, I'll tell you what, and I have been to 20 or 30 of the Safer Bangers, maybe 20, because I know there was a period I wasn't going to them for whatever reason. A guy would get his thing, and way to do it is that they're really good about not letting the cat out of the bag who's going to get in. It's usually three people, sometimes it's two. But when the presenter, whoever they may be, sometimes it's me, sometimes it's Joe Saraceno, sometimes it's, you know, TK's, he's inducted some people. When you start reading the guy, and it's funny because I try not to make eye contact with the guy who's getting in while I'm reading it. But sometimes you just can't help it. And they're doing this. They're like, you know, trying to see who's it going to be. And then something clicks and they're like, oh. And then they get it and they come up and they get their plaque and they see their name on the big plaque. And you see the tears of joy in their eyes. And I'll tell you what, I've handed that plaque to a lot of individuals over the years, and it makes me proud to be a part of that. The best one I ever gave, the best one I ever gave was to Big Sal from Big Sal's Race Engines, who has built a lot of race engines for the figure eight guys, a lot of wins, a lot of championships. And he had no clue. Even after his name was said, he just sat there. You know, it's just, that's what it's all about. But my thing now, my plug moving forward for the Figure Eight Hall of Fame is the guys who raced at Riverhead. They need to be recognized. And for some reason, they have not been, with the exception of one individual. And I can't remember his name. It was there. I was starting to write it down. It'll come to me. And WJ might be a level. He drove the Vitucho modified before JR. Don Howe. Thank you, WJ. I can remember calling his wife and kind of feeling her out to see if that would be something. I remember talking to Joe Vitucho. I said, listen, we need to get him here. We need to get him at the dinner. And the Gershaw Group, they bought a bunch of tickets, and one of the things he said, that Don Howe said, and this is what made me feel that some of the Riverhead guys, and I don't mean the Riverhead guys from now, I'm talking about the guys in the 60s and the 70s. He said, it's nice to know that guys like us that raced in the 60s and the 70s are being recognized for what we did. And you know, like Greg Sachs, who went into the Sprint Cup Series, you know, and I think his best season he finished maybe 33rd in the points. But I mean, I really don't know. But I know he wasn't a top runner. He ran. Don't get me wrong. He ran some good races, but he was a figure eight guy. Benny Parsons, Grand National champ, 1973, won the championship, putting 182,000 in his pocket, was a figure eight champion. Now, I'm not saying that we, you know, let him rest in peace, but I'm not saying that Benny Parsons should be in the Safer Hall of Fame. Maybe he should be. I don't know. But we need to recognize some of these, because what's happening now, and this is a no diss to any of the members who are going to be put into this Hall of Fame moving forward, because I know who's going in for this year, and well-deserving. But what do we do next year? What do we do the year after that? I always argued my case with the committee. If the guy's still racing, I'm not thinking he should be in the Hall of Fame. It'd be like saying, all right, Derek Jeter is still playing, but you know what? Let's put him in the Hall of Fame, the baseball. Let's not. He's still a player. So let's not put in a racer. And yes, Dan Giovinelli was a figure eight driver. I believe he won a figure eight championship, if I'm not mistaken. And I believe... out of that little gang that raced figure eights in the 60s and 70s, I believe Danny Turbish is, I think, number two or three in wins. And he stayed that way until ISOP closed and the ISOP guys came out. But, you know, back in the day, you had two choices of race car to drive on Long Island. you drove a modified, or you drove a figure eight. Yeah, Freeport had the bomber class, and you know, and not to take anything away from those guys and gals that drove bomber. I'll tell you what, it takes a special breed of person to do that. But it was different, you know, back even back then. You know, in I guess the 70s, the late 70s, and again, I wasn't a Freeport Municipal Stadium regular. I maybe went there three times in my whole entire life. But, you know, they had, you know, their modifieds, they had late models, and they had the bombers, the bomber stocks. And you know, when you look at that, I you didn't really have too many options. Suffolk people, Suffolk County, Long Island, that's the east end of Long Island, they didn't go out to Freeport, and the people in Queens and Freeport, the Nassau County, didn't go out east. It was too far. It was too far to go. Now guys on Long Island drive past Riverhead Raceway and they go to Mountain Speedway in Pennsylvania. I'll never understand that. But anyway. So what do you do? So you water down the members in the Hall of Fame. Instead of doing three, do you do maybe one, or one solid deserving? Do you go back? Do you go out and get the record books? You go through the record books, flip the pages, and say, "Hey, wait a minute, who did we leave out?" You know, and WJ makes a point. You know, the LIE didn't go all the way out there back then, and hey, you know what? I don't disagree with that. But go to Pocono Raceway. Once you get off Route 80, you're on like a side road. Martinsville Speedway is on a two lane highway. In downtown Ridgeway, Virginia. I'm sure it wasn't easy to get there either. But if you want to race, you go racing. But you know what's kind of funny? When it was raining in Freeport and not raining in Iceland, those guys packed up and they showed up. All the days that it was raining in Iceland, but not in Riverhead. It's only like 40, 50 miles. It could be raining in one place and not the other. So they would do that. They would do that. I mean, the LIE, I think, ended in the 60s. I think it ended at exit 54. And before that, it ended, I think, way before the SAG occurs, you know. And you can use Route 58. I use 220. I use 220 from the, because I have, you know, I fly in. So I take the 220 bypass. I don't take the 220 business. But, you know, it's different. The highway system is different now. But you know what? You know, I'm glad you said that, because now you triggered a little thing here in my brain. It's easier to get to now, but there's less cars. What's wrong with that picture? I'm just throwing it out there. It ended. I can remember the first time I raced out in Riverhead. I went out with Fred Dunlop Jr. We went out, and I remember going out there, and it seemed like forever. It seemed like it was a trip and a half to go out there. It was back 76, 77, and I went and raced out there for the first time. And, you know, an Iceland Speedway was 15 minutes from my house in Babylon, so it was an hour. It took an hour. It might have taken all a little bit longer, because I had to go from Babylon to St. James to pick up Fred, then go out to Riverhead. Because he had a place in St. James. And remember, he lent me his fire suit. I didn't have a fire suit. I didn't know. What did I know? I went to TSS Times Square Store and bought my first race crash helmet. And I can remember I didn't spend a lot of money on it. And then the PR guy says, he goes, "I guess if you have a $20 head, you get a $20 helmet." And I guess it was I look back and he wasn't wrong. And yeah, it was easy to get there. It was right off of Sunrise Highway. And I can remember, I used to think there was an old radio tower with a red blinking light for the planes so they wouldn't hit it. And I used to think that was the racetrack when I was a kid growing up driving down Sunrise Highway, because my dad would think of no racer. He thought racing was stupid. And I used to think that was where the racetrack, I thought that was the infield, you know, until I finally went there. And it's really across the street. But you know, those were the days. Those were the days. Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, I had a pizza box firewall and a $5 helmet from Times Square stores. But they didn't tech stuff back then. It didn't look like they look now. My fire suit, I'm trying to think what I had for a fire suit. I had this old stupid thing. I didn't even have like a real fire suit. In fact, I don't even think when I first raced, you needed a fire suit when I first raced. You know, I look back and like the first seat in the first car, like I drove in the figure eight, it was a barrel cut with a saw, with like a sawzall, in the shape of a seat, but it had a seat thing on it, a seat cover on it. You know, who knew? You know, I wasn't one of those t-shirt guys, right? Because I'm not a t-shirt guy today. But, and I didn't wear jeans, so I knew I had something. I probably had like some nice slacks or something, because I always dressed kind of weird to go to the racetrack, and people didn't understand why I dressed the way I did. But, you know, when I look back on that, you know, it was different. It was different. And I can remember drives. I can remember my Uncle John. He wore a button-down red shirt with his cool Filter Kings in his shirt pocket. And, you know, when he'd pull out of the race, he'd pull into the infield, he'd get that big cigarette, you know, all 5 foot one of them. I'll tell you, I miss that guy. We had a lot of laughs with him. You know, in fact, I want to share a story. You know, one of the first times I ever raced with or against, I should say, my Uncle John. I didn't have like a decent car, but I was out there, you know, I'm trying. And I come in, we lined up, and see, a nice little thing was that we lined up on, there was no hot laps. We lined up on the backstretch. The lights flickered in turn three, you could see them, and you went, started Ray Mortuano, waved the green flag, you weren't racing. And I remember lining up, going out on the track and getting in my spot. And I remember going past, driving past my Uncle John, and he was driving a 77, an old, I think it was a 1950 Ford. And the car would belong to Fred Dunlop Jr., who was probably 6'2", 250, big guy, big solid muscle guy. And then my Uncle Johnny was probably 5'1", 90 pounds, soaking wet, with an 18 pack on his shoulder, you know? And we had street tires. And we had recaps, actually. And I can remember, I said, wow, this is cool. I remember as I drove past him, I nodded, he nodded. And I was like, I remember as a kid, little kid watching the race, and now I'm racing with him. To me, that was a dream come true. So like I said, I wasn't really that good, son. And I think I learned how to drive a standard shift car on the racetrack, so I really, really wasn't that good. So the green flag flies, and I hold up the whole inside row, the whole outside row goes, because I'm not good at shifting, you know, banging through the gears, even though it was only a 3-speed, and we ran second. So I catch up to my uncle. I catch up to him. And as I go by, I do a double take, because all I saw was two hands on the steering wheel moving. I was like, what the heck? Well, to make a short story long, get into the pits, I was like, what happened? Well, I didn't know that they took two inner tubes, one on the bottom of the seat to raise him up, and one behind his back to push him forward so he could reach the steering wheel and pedals. And the inner tubes popped. You can ask anybody. Anybody was around back then. The inner tubes popped, but he was still holding on trying to drive. These are the things that you know, stick in your head sometimes. And we had a good time with stuff like that, a real good time. You know, Dave Loud and this guy from Brooklyn, who I believe bought Eddie Piron's car, the 24 Crunch car. And this guy was the first guy that I knew that came into our class, because he had class. He owned a shoe store in like a ritzy part of Manhattan. He dressed impeccable. His car was always good. He lived in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn. And I can remember there was a wreck, and I think I was a part of it, but he had spun around, and he never buckled his helmet. And he had one of the, he was one of the first guys to have a full face helmet. I can remember he got hit and the helmet spun. And I get out of the car, I'm like kind of sitting on the door jam, I'm like, oh, this is horrible. How am I gonna fix this? I don't know how to do this stuff. And I hear him say, I hear somebody yelling. I lost my sight, I can't see. So I look over to his car, and his helmet's facing the other way. I was like, wow, this guy hit pretty bad. It spun his head around. But what happened was the helmet spun around, and when he opened his eyes, it was pitch dark, and he thought he lost his vision. But those are the things that we had, you know, did in those days. It was fun. It was fun. We had a good time. And I can remember when I finally got my own car and I rolled it into my garage at home in West Bowen, and I told my mother it was TK's car, because that's her brother. She's not gonna tell us her brother. He can't keep the car in the garage, you know. And then it's kind of funny because, you know, I even called up my house that, you know, I was at the racetrack and I bought the car, and the guy I bought the car from, Clay Walston, he towed it to the track. And then at the end of the day, I'm still trying to figure out where I'm going to put this thing. And he goes, "Hey, where are we going with this?" I said, "Hold on." So I go to the payphone. Remember payphones? I had payphones at the racetrack. I go to the payphone and I call up, "Hey, listen, you know, Uncle Tom, you know, has this race car. And you know, can you put it in the garage for a couple of weeks? Because the season was over. It was like the last race, I think." Yeah. It's just for a couple of weeks. So we roll it in, we get it there, put it in the garage, and then Sunday morning I got to go out and look at it. You know, I got to look. It's my race car now. I got to look at it. It's in my garage. And my dad went to church and came back and something. I could tell he's not too thrilled about this thing. Well, lo and behold, TK Tom Craver just happens to stop over the house, and I'm like, "Oh, this is working out good," because I told him it's his car, and if it's his car, why isn't he here looking at it with me? You know. And we sat down and we had some laughs over that, and you know, and what happened was the way my mother found out it wasn't my car is because my mother was talking to her sister, who happened to be Tom's sister also, and my mother goes, "Yeah, our brother's race car is in my garage," and my aunt goes, "That's not our brother's car, that's your son's race car." So I had to find a new place for that, like, right quick, let me tell you. So hey, Kevin, back from the fire. How did I know Bumblefork, F-O-O-K, is Kevin? Because Kevin just got back from the firehouse. And we missed a lot of good things. We gave away all kinds of prizes and dinners and all kinds of stuff. You missed out the first hour. No, I'm only kidding. We didn't. We just talked. I'm just rambling because there was no reason. But I'm having a good time talking. It's like I'm talking to myself. This is how I write books, because I'm in my car and I'm driving and I think of something, and I always have a pad on my seat, and I'll make like a one line. I can make a whole chapter out of it. April Fool's. Yeah. I didn't even think of it. I didn't even realize it was April. I mean, I knew it was April Fool's, but I didn't do anything. I didn't do any April Fool's jokes to people. I know Wayne Okula, former Blunderbuss standout and crew chief on the Don King Whelen Modified Tour, he had a good one on the social media today that a certain individual bought the local racetrack here on Long Island, and that the head official had to step down. Steve had to step down because he had to run the tire concession, and somebody else had to step down, and that they made me the head technical inspector. Now, you know that's a joke. Me, the head technical guy? You know, I don't think so. Although I do know what to look for. I just can't fix it if it's broke. And I can't. Could you wait any quicker? Type any faster to write that? Don't get me wrong. There's things that I can do if you're pushed, if I really had to. But I don't know. I just don't. Maybe I don't like. I don't know. I don't like to. You got to understand. In the 70s, I crashed so many. I tore so many right fronts off in the 70s because we ran on the oval to qualify, and if it rained. For a feature, we ran on the feature on the oval the following week. And I tore up so many right fronts that I knew I could, I got real good at changing right fronts. So anyway, let's see, Kevin Basic, Long Island Need for Speed saying, "I wish the track was looking for help. He's trying to get press passes." Oh yes, press passes, good luck. Jay Slice is saying here, "I paint well and do sheet metal bodies good." You know why? A, because I tore off so many body panels in my day, I got real good at making them. Because back when I started racing, you didn't call the parts guy. I need a Mustang body kit sent to me. No, you had to go to the junkyard. You had to find them. And so, I watched Clay Walston take a piece of metal, put his mangled fender on. He beat it with a rubber mallet, beat it so it was flat, and then he put it on the sheet metal. And then he cut it with tin snips, because he didn't have, you know, plasma cutters. He cut it with tin snips, and then he bent it to where it had to be. So that's what I learned how to do. And I'll tell you something. I wish more people could have seen what we went through when you guys first came to my shop and we're going to do Blunderbuss Con. And I think practice, you came like Saturday, and practice was the following Saturday. And all was sitting there, it was a chassis rail and a roll cage with the drive chain in it. And I remember your brother saying, "You think we'll be ready for opening day?" I said, "We're going to be ready for practice." He goes, "There's no body. I'll make a body. Don't worry about it." And we knocked it out. Even your father came. He couldn't believe it. But if it don't start, and I'm saying this, I'm serious. If I flip all my switches on my race car and then press the button and start, and it don't start, I don't know what to do. I don't know. I have no clue. You know, one time I'm sitting at Riverhead. I'm online. And for some reason we pushed it, because I think I parked so close we just pushed it up. Then it came time to go, and I hit what I thought was all the right switches, pressed the button, nothing. Turned out I forgot to put the battery switch on. But I was ready to park. I guess we're done. yes. Yep, the good old days. Get push trucks. I did that too. There was a couple times at Islip where it wouldn't start. I just turned what I knew was the ignition, because the light went on my dashboard to tell me that it was on. And then I had them push me and I just popped the clutch. But anyway, but yeah, there was, you know, there's a lot of jobs at the racetrack, you know, good jobs. You know, 13 hours of work, $20 for the night, and all the pizza. I don't know if they still do pizza. It's been a long time since I went there. I know when Bill Dennison was running the place, it was always pizza. That guy ate pizza 7 days a week. But I don't know if there's still pizza. I know when I was the head guy, I didn't bring pizza. I brought like stuff. I had a delicatessen and like 6 foot heroes and salads and stuff. You know, but they don't get concession stand food. Somebody's paying for that food. Because I remember I asked for that. I asked if my officials could get food at the concession stand. I was told no. So I don't know where they get the food from now. But again, it's been like a year and a half since I really have been there, you know, not counting tour races. But it's different. It's different. And sometimes different is good. I don't know. What do you think? Do you think different is good? I don't know. But Kevin, that would be like a good idea, because if you got on the track crew, you'd be on the infield. And then they'd pay you to be there. You wouldn't have to beg them for stuff. I'm thinking that's the route to go. Kevin, what do you think? Kevin, basics, Long Island Need for Speed. I believe it's Channel 115 Woodbury Cablevision on Thursday nights at 8:00. If I gave out any bad info, there you go. Wow, I have that. How come I can remember that, but I can't remember what I have for breakfast? I don't understand that. But it's that's what you need to do, Kevin. I'm thinking that's what you need to do. You put the little camera, you can put it on the dash of the sweeper truck. You wear like a helmet cam. You can wear a helmet cam, you know, like some of the pit crew guys do. And I think that would work, you know, because there's nothing in the rules that says you can't wear a helmet cam. You want to have a helmet in case you get hit by a car, God forbid, you know. Oh, yes, we're having fun tonight. But I think that's what you need to do, Kevin. And maybe the best way to make that happen is I should call them and say, whatever you do, don't hire Kevin, because they do whatever I say, the opposite. So, yeah, you know, it's funny. Jay Slice, well, you're going to get me in trouble with that comment. I have a racing only memory. Let's see. Hey, those DVDs, I'll tell you what, there's probably like 50 hours of DVDs, Kevin, that you gave me. 50 hours, it's got to be. I'm looking at them. I'm like, holy cow. And you know, it's funny, in one of them I saw one of my old cars like pulling by. It's kind of cool. I thought it was good anyway. I really did, you know. But it's fun stuff. It's fun stuff, and I'm loving it. I'm loving it. But Kevin, that's what I'm thinking. What do you think? Let's try that. I'll call up and say, listen, what you should guys don't even think of. Kevin Basic wants a job, don't hire him. And I'm telling you, they'll hire you, because they do whatever I say the opposite, because they don't like me there. But I understand why, because I say stupid stuff. I say stupid stuff and they don't like it. But I don't mean it in a bad way. You know, They just, they say stupid stuff. But it's the season's going to be starting in a month, and you know, you might want to get the ball rolling. In fact, I have to give them the list of when I'm going to come, because I've been told that as a NASCAR employee, and according to the sanction agreement, I get in for nothing. So I have to do that. I have to remind them. Every once in a while, I remind them. And not that I'm looking to become like a regular fixture there, but there are some nights where I'd like to go. And I'd like to see, you know, some of the old guys, some of my old buddies. I won't do it. For you, man, I won't do it. Hey, speaking of DVDs, there was one that I was hoping, and I'm going off on another tangent again. There was one that you did at my house, a DVD of me. I was wondering if you had that, and if I could get that from you. And I will trade for you the Sal Licardi show. I will trade that when Sal Licardi Sr. was on. And I'll trade you straight up DVD for DVD. And if we could make that happen. Because I thought that was a good one, and especially when we were in my office and I couldn't remember Ray Evahan's name. And you thought I was kidding. No, I wasn't kidding. I couldn't remember. I figured, you know what's funny? I don't know how Captain Video does it. He's another guy who does video. He must have like a computer index of all his things, because you could say to him, hey, Cap, September 3rd, 1986, do you have the figure eight feature? Hold on. Yeah, I got it right here. You want it? Come get it. And you go there, and it's like nothing but the DVDs and tapes. Like there's no wallpaper. It's just tapes and DVDs. You know? But he has some good stuff. It's all good. It's all good. And you know, all you guys that do that, I'll tell you what, I got to give you my hats off to you. My hats off to you, because it takes a lot. It takes a lot. You guys are doing this out of your own pocket. I'm glad you said that, WJ. But, you know, you guys are out there taking pictures, and a lot of this stuff is done. You don't get anything out of it. And not that we do this to get anything out of it, but, you know, it costs money, A, to go to these events, B, the time that it takes out. You take a gazillion pictures, and you got to do what you got to do and post and write. You're up all night, you know, like WJ with MyRaceNews.com. His stories are genuine, you know, genuine. And it takes a lot of thought. My publisher just sent one of my books back. He just sent it back. He told me to rewrite it. I was like, I don't have time for this. And not that I have to rewrite it totally. Just there's a couple of things he wants me to change. And you know, him and I were back and forth. And sometimes he listens, and but he doesn't chat, which sometimes is a good thing. But there was like, you know, he told me I was missing commas all over the place. So. Oh, good, you get press passes, that's good. But, you know, when you know, I'm sitting in, and then it has to be in this new format, and I'm just thinking, why can't I just send you the Word doc and you put it in that format? Well, he doesn't do that anymore, so I got to do that. But when I do it in my computer, my paragraph spacing changes, and I got to look and figure it out. But anyway, that's my problem, not yours. But doing the photo shoot, I think, he wanted to do the photo shoot next week, but I don't have time to do that. And he is a good guy, Jeff Neubauer, BK Books, Inc. I thought I only had two new books coming out, plus the re-release of A View from the Ramp, but I have three new books coming out, because I forgot about one that I did. Can you believe that? I wrote a book, I forgot about it. You know, I got A View from the Backseat, A View from the Inside, and A View from the Front Office. All done, I just gotta clean some stuff up. But and he is nuts, man. Holy jeez. In fact, he actually told somebody, he thought I was selling my books to another publishing company. He told somebody that I forget what the word was. I'm not sure if he said peddling my books or trying to sell my books somewhere else. Yeah, it's not the case, ladies and gentlemen, because I'm loyal to those who are loyal to me. So, and he was loyal to me. First, you know. My checkbook. Speaking of which, I can't find my checkbook. I don't know what I did with it. I got checks I got to write, and I can't find it. I can't find my checkbook. But my checkbook, yeah. Well, you know, it's April 1st. You know what that means? It's UPS pension time. So that's a good thing. And then I got the books. And with those three books going to be out, I'm, like I said, I'm supposed to do the photo shoot. And with, my covers are going to be like real pictures, like in on some of the new books that are out, like Race Across the Moon by Jeff Neubauer. And the You book that he has out. So that should be interesting. You know, it's like once I clean up my comm, because I have, he said I'm missing a bunch of commas, so I gotta fix some of the things, and I gotta redo the spacing and put it on, and get it into this thing, so that we're doing some good stuff here, so that we can get it on. So I'm thinking this month. They should have been out a couple months ago, but that was shame on me. So. Got a call? Oh, let's see. We got an old-fashioned phone here, which is okay.
No. You should be able to talk to him just fine.
Oh, okay. Hey, Kevin, you out there?
Yeah, I'm out there. You shouldn't have to bribe me. How are you?
Yeah.
Huh?
How you doing? I'm going to turn you up a little bit here. How's that?
Oh, okay. You shouldn't have to bribe me about the DVD. I have it. I have to go through my stuff.
Yeah, I got to see if I can hear you better. That might be a little better.
Is it better? Yeah. Can you hear me?
You still there? Did I lose you?
No, I'm still here. I hear you. Hello, clear. Go low.
Oh, yeah, that's good. I can hear you now. Can you hear me now? Wow.
So I have that DVD. I have to go through the archive. I've got to find it.
Okay. Remember that? That was good, because we went to the garage or something for dinner, and they had the band playing, and
we
did some dancing. That, yeah. Not that I'm a dancer. My dancing days are over, but it was good. It was good.
Yeah, we had a good time.
Yeah, that was good, because then you came. Then we're back to that. We went to my office, and we took. I had like a little shrine in my office of racing stuff, but that I don't have anymore. All my stuff's in a tote box now.
Oh, that's not good.
But it's all good. It's all good.
Yeah, but I have some stuff, thank God, for Ricky Miller. I got over like 2,000 VHS tapes here. I swear to God. It's like Marty Himes' front door. As you walk in the lobby there, you know, of his house there.
Oh, wow.
I swear to God, I've got Karen just keeps giving me DVDs. I mean, that guy, forget about it. I got stuff from the 60s, 70s.
Wow.
All sprint cars, modifies. I've got Indy cars. I've got Daytona stuff from Fireball Roberts that he gave me, all sorts of stuff. I've been using it, you know?
Oh, nice. I know Ricky had a lot of stuff, Ricky had.
Oh, my God.
A lot of stuff. And one of my best memories going to some Sprint Cup races, going to Bristol with Ricky and Karen, and we had such a good time. And the race, the Nationwide race was snowed out on Saturday, believe it or not. But we had a great time.
He was a good guy, and he knew about fire department racing and stuff like that too, because he was a fireman. He raced with the drill team and stuff like that. They ran old fashioned, but he knew all the motorized stuff, state circuits, all sorts of stuff.
Well, when you did the show with me to promote my first book, we did it at the Lynbrook Fire House.
Yeah, right.
And in the middle of the show, you got a call. You get something. Gotta go. There's a fire.
So we went outside and we filmed him getting in the truck and everything. Yeah, I couldn't believe he still ran. Yeah, still
we went. Just stood out there waiting. Okay, the fire's out. Come back.
Yeah, that was a good day. Yeah,
he's good people. You know, Ricky and Karen.
Yeah, I miss the guy. I really do.
And you know, doing that show, Speed Racing Radio, with Jeff Bressler and Ricky Miller and Mike Fields for a little while, it was like a weekly night out. And then especially when we started broadcasting from the ESPN zone at the Uniondale Marriott next door to the Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum, we had some good times. And you know, those are the memories you don't forget. You know.
Yeah. Right.
And I had a lot of, and you drove with him to all the places. You know, you and him were like inseparable.
Oh, yeah, all over. We went all over.
You know, Ricky. And you know, it was good when I went to the banquets, to the NASCAR banquets, and even in the Cup banquet, when they broadcast it and they listed the people who passed this year. And when I saw Ricky Miller's name, you get choked up. You know, he was recognized. NASCAR recognized him. He was one. He goes, those in our racing family that passed this year, and there was Ricky Miller, and I had a DVD, you know, DVR, whatever you call that, and when I, And I played it back just to make sure I read it right, and it was Ricky Miller. He was a good guy. Good guy.
Yeah, Joe, today the Gary Danko show is back on. I think that Valente series is going to really take off.
I do too.
They got over 30 freaking cars. They're running almost 20-something races.
I know.
It's a shame. I think NASCAR don't want mods. I keep saying that.
But it's funny. At the World Series at Thompson this past year, Chad Little said to me, go down there and see how many cars they got. I'm hearing numbers, and just go verify that. So I go down there, and sure enough, they had way more cars than the modified tour did. And what he came back and he said to me, well, who's there? And I said, Chad, I don't want to sound like a wise guy, but 9 out of 10 guys that are in those cars over there used to run with us.
Yeah, they even have a tire rule. You can only buy 4 tires per race, believe it or not.
Well, what is it? You could buy a certain amount opening day, and then you can only buy a certain amount every other race after that.
Yeah, right. So that's a good idea.
I think it is too, because it saves on the course. Because I'll tell you what, and these guys in the modified series, you're only allowed to use 10 tires. You know, 4 to qualify, 4 change tires, and 2 emergency. So that's 10. But some of the big dollar teams, they're putting on 4 stickers every practice to get the right balance and the right stagger and the right offset and the right this, that, and the other thing. And then there's Wade Cole going through the tire pile trying to find 4 good ones.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to buy 4 stickers. It used to be he didn't have to buy 4 stickers. Now they're making him buy 4 stickers. And he buys those 4 stickers, and then he's in the tire pile trying to find other tires. A guy like that, maybe that other series is ideal for him. And I think we're gonna. I'm trying to push people out of the NASCAR Wheel Modified Tour, NASCAR, because I know somebody who's from NASCAR watches this or listens. But there's a guy that would be better suited for that series. Just as I'm sure there's guys in that series that would be better suited to come race for us.
Even the Cup Series. Look at the stands. They're empty.
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 Empty. You would think it was a makeup race from a rainout sometimes, the way that the stands look.
Boring. I don't even watch it anymore. I think they push Earnhardt because he's leading the points, so it makes people come back as a big Earnhardt fan.
Yeah, and I think that's going to happen. You know, they got, and I'm not saying they manipulate outcomes, but, I got to be careful what I say here, but it just seems like certain things are convenient in the NASCAR world where there's just certain things happen to stir up the media instead of the
like
fans.
Like WWF.
Yeah, you know, I'm glad. I agree with that. You know, NASCAR makes a lot of money off the modified tour. All the series, they make a lot of money. But what's happening now is the tracks aren't making the money they used to have because they need the pit gate to pay the purses. And when you used to show up with 45 cars and you're showing up with 25, and the average team had 12 crew guys and now they have 8. When you do the math, there's a lot of people missing. A lot of people.
Even the True Value, I mean, not True Value, the ROC is doing really good too, believe it or not.
Yeah.
They got dirt and asphalt.
Well, you know, Ed Cox, the former series director before Chad Little, I can remember going to a meeting. It was him and I was the race director. And we went to the meeting. We were in the clubhouse at Thompson, and he invited some key car owners and some key drivers. And he said to them, he said, guys, listen, he goes, you got to stay loyal to us because if you're going to race for $1,500 to win, then they're going to lower our purses, which they have. And they're going to rather have those traveling series there instead of us. And you're starting to see that. And you're starting to see that. And when you have, you know, when you go to the World Series and there's more Valenti modified racing series cars than Wheeler modified tour cars, and for the most part, they are the same exact cars. And when the modified tour is running for, you know, like 6,000 or 7,000 to win, and you know, 650 to take the green, when the other guys are racing for 1,500 to win and 200 to take the green, why do they have more cars? Because they have more cars because their course is different.
Yeah, they had over 30 cars at Waterford. Actually, their first Valente race is this Saturday night.
Right.
So they had over 30 cars practicing.
Yeah.
From the Valente series, just warm-ups.
Yep, just for one. And there were a handful of tour guys that were at that warm-up as well. And I know
they're practicing because the tour is going to go there.
They're going
to
go there. But I'll tell you what, though, and maybe I'm not too bright, but maybe, I don't know, but I'm thinking that the racetrack they're going to practice on in March is not going to be the same racetrack they're going to race on in May.
Nah, it's
a whole
different
layout.
Crazy,
heat,
hot.
Yeah.
And by the way, is anybody interested in buying some vintage modifiers? Because my brother's got all his shit up for sale.
I got to ring the bell there. Yeah, we'll let them know. Yeah, I mean, the guys are listening, and I'm sure there's some interest here. The vintage stuff is good. I was up at Lime Rock. I saw a vintage race, and I'll tell you what, I sat on the hillside and watched. Those were the days.
It's getting too expensive to even run those things, and we do it out of pleasure. I mean, it's ridiculous.
It's you know, no matter what you want to race, it's going to cost money. It's going to cost a ton of money, and that's why that's why 2013 is going to be a little different. So, but
yeah, right.
We'll see.
Let's hope it's a good time out east there. I hope they have cars and stuff. You know what I'm saying? I hope they do.
Yeah.
I hope they have fans.
Yeah. I'm concerned about some of the schedules, not only at some of the weekly tracks, but even on the tour. I mean, that's another reason why the tour doesn't have the cars that it once has, because those other series are racing on the off nights. And if you're a racer, you're a racer, and you're going to go racing. And I think that's what's
important. NASCAR should promote the mods more, and they should put the cup drivers in there and whatever, and switch them around. Let the cup cars get away and let the freaking cup guys drive modifies.
Yeah.
NASCAR started with modifies. I'm pretty sure Tony Stewart would rather drive a modify than, what do you call it? And that's why I like Baldwin in a way, because Baldwin promotes modify racing.
He does.
Modify drivers in his cars. And
he does.
I like that.
And you know, when you look at the first year of NASCAR, 1948, it's called the 1948 NASCAR Modified Point Series, where Red Byron was the champion, you know, putting $13,000 in his pocket after 34 starts. You know, they were called modifieds. Because you went to the dealership, you bought a car and you modified it. You weren't racing, you know. And then 1949, they called them strictly stocks. They were trying to get the right name. But then again, Red Byron wins again. Wins the championship and puts $5,800 in his pocket that year. So, but they only had six races. So, you know, but that's the thing.
Yeah, I want to ask Walter a question. He said that he talked to somebody about Rivet. How many mods are going to be out there? Other tracks, I swear to God, like Mountain and stuff, are going to get like 30 cars.
I'll tell you.
Paying $3,000 to win for a Saturday night.
I know. You know, it's funny. Just recently, I threw away my entry plan. I used to save everything. And me and TK on paper, we owned, he physically had a modified. He had bought a Lenny Fisher modified. It was probably 1980. And I was listed as the car owner. So I got all the entry blanks. And I was just looking at them. And, you know, 10,000 a win, 15,000 a win, 9,000 a win. And then you look at the same event today, 5,000 a win, 6,000 a win. You're talking 30 years ago. You could make a living racing back then. You could make a living.
Richie Evans did. Jerry Cook. Corky Cookman. There's a whole bunch of guys that did it. George Kent. They all followed one another around.
You know, the good old days. The real good old days. You know, WJ had a conversation today about how many mods on Long Island this year with someone from Riverhead Raceway. And then the answer was 18 to 22. Woof. 18 to 22, you know, that's, I don't know, there's just a lot of divisions are hurting, and I think one of the things that happens, and this is where my hat's off to like a Thompson and a Stafford up in Connecticut, they don't start new divisions in the hopes of getting new drivers, they run with what they have. Because that's what happened. That's what's happened here on Long Island. The car count started to dwindle. So you know what? Oh, somebody goes to them. You know, if we had this division, we'd have more cars. So they have they
like
open
the
this.
The bus should be figure eights, Joe.
Absolutely.
I
agree.
A couple weeks ago on Speed, they had them out west. They were blunderbuss cars running figure eights.
Yeah. I mean, when you think about it, that's, yeah. You know what?
Roger Maynard said he'd go back to running that way, but the majority of the guys don't want to do it.
You know, it's like I said, I was at in early in the show, I was talking about, I was at the Safer meeting last week, the third Tuesday of the month, however that felt. And we were talking about that, and we're talking about how many cars we're going to have, and it annoys the crap out of me. I'm going to be quite blunt, and I know there's one or two Safer guys that are listening to the show, that they're going to sit there with a piece of paper and a pen. All right, how many cars do we have? And they go down a list. Oh, we got 15, 16, whatever. This guy has two cars, him and his son. And I'm like, instead of writing it on a piece of paper, pick up the dang phone and call up, hey, so-and-so, what are you doing? And then you find out the truth.
Your old driver's car is sitting behind his house right now, all covered up with canvas. There ain't no body on it or nothing, no motor.
He's on. He just said that they may, if the weather holds up, they'll be out. They're going to make it.
Like I said, at Betty's house the other day, just checking up, she's in Florida.
Maybe I got to go out there and drop a body on there for them, because I can make that happen in a night. Right, Mr. Slice? I'm pretty good at that. And speaking of Mr. Slice, he heard a rumor that John Fortin will be going to Mountain Speedway in Pennsylvania with his three cars. Because John Fortin has his car, his daughter's got his son's car. And I know he's just had about enough of the local racing.
They treat him good up there. They treat anybody good.
They do. It's you know, they really do. And I don't know, WJ, if you look at the old 29 blunderbuss car, my panels mirrored that of a stock showroom Impala, and Mr. Slice can confirm that. Can you, Mr. Slice? But anyway, but they do. They treat and. And, you know, I know when Mike Mortimer was going up to Seekonk a couple of years ago, he missed 2 weeks in a row, and the owner of the racetrack called him up, wanted to know if everything was okay.
I have videos of him racing up there.
He missed two races in a row, you know, and they called. And, you know, I don't think that happens at a lot of racetracks, you know. I don't know. I know... You know, back in the day when I was the chief official here on Long Island, if a guy missed a week or two, I used to call them up. Not because I was told to, because I needed to know why they weren't there. Was it something that I did? Sometimes it was something I did, and you're able to patch it out over a pizza and a beer or a burger and a beer. But sometimes it was they didn't have the money. Sometimes they needed tires, sometimes they needed a motor. And there's a lot of cars racing at that place that have my stuff in it still. So,
yeah, like I used to tell you last time we were there, 3 weeks ago, Long Island used to be the hotbed of racing. Richie Evans used to come Friday nights with Jerry Cook, run Freeport, and stay over and run Islip. Or Bugsy Stevens used to come down from, instead of running Stafford, he used to come down and run, Islip Speedway or whatever. They all came here. They all came here instead of running their local tracks because Bob O'Rourke treated them good.
He did.
Larry Mettleson, they treated him good. That's how the All-Star League got started and stuff.
You know, but that's how, you know, that's missing. You know, that's missing today. I don't know why. And, you know, people here, they're talking, Harry Man.
Take care of your races and take care of your fans. Get the fans in for $5 a head. You can pack the place.
I know.
Food. You can still make money, buddy.
I know.
You can make money.
You know, it's kind of funny because I've had this conversation with management over the years, and Harry Mann could confirm this. You know, if you have 500 people in the stands at $30 a head, you made $15,000. But if you have 3,500 people in the stands and you charge them $5, you made $17,500. And if each person spends $100 in the concession, you know, the 500 count group is, you're only talking that they're going to spend another $5,000, so that gives them $20,000. But 3,500 people spend $35,000, so that gives them $50,000. They don't see that, you know. They don't see that. You know, you're going to get the guy or gal's money. You're going to get that $100 bill. Why do you got to get the whole $100 bill at the back gate? I don't understand.
Definitely take care of your drivers. Give them, like I said, 3,000. I would make Long Island the highest paid NASCAR track on the Northeast, and you'll have freaking people from Jersey, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, all come here to race.
It used to be. This is where they came. Guys, Jerry Cook, Richie, they came from upstate New York to race here in Long Island. It wasn't cheap back then. It wasn't cheap.
Yeah, it's at least a 5-hour ride, 4-hour ride.
You know, like Harriman says, you know, admission is a small part of the track's revenue, the track management things. Well, and I can remember when I was involved and I knew the numbers and I knew what was coming in, I knew what was going out. They needed 970 something people in the pits to cover all the expenses. And if they had that, everything that was in the grandstands was gravy. Every ticket, every beer, every soda, every candy bar was gravy.
How many fans can you fit in Riverhead Raceway? Figure it that way. You figure out like $5 or $10 a head.
Yeah, with a 17-inch seat footprint, it's like just under 3,500.
So figure that out. $10 a head.
That's 35,000.
For one Saturday night, I'd take it. I wouldn't be greedy. I'd take it.
Yeah,
and if and concession. I'd even lower the prices there too and stuff. Really.
And your pit gate, if you have 1,000 people in the pits, and it's only $20 to get in, that's 20 grand. But if you got 500 people in the pits, at 30, that's 15 grand. You know, it's addition by subtraction. They don't understand that.
Well, what are you gonna do?
Because they're caught up in a paradigm of this is how we always did it. That's the problem.
They should just step aside, let somebody manage the track for them, and all of a sudden they'll be freaking out because they got so much money they won't know what to do with it all.
Yeah, exactly. And somebody's talking about a recent newspaper article that said it seats 2,000. And I know where that number came from, and why they say that. Well, I guess I could say why, but and we're going to call this just my opinion. The reason they say that is they got to pay. There's a sporting event tax that they got to pay, so they'd rather say that there's 2,000 than 3,500. But that's just whatever.
And like I said, Joe, the track needs a paving too, man. I walked that track.
Does.
I'm like, oh my God! And then if you look from the wall out to the track, there's like a 1-inch gap. I don't know if that's for freaking frost or whatever, but
no, that's
separate.
There's
actually weeds growing through there.
You know, and the track needs to be paved properly. It needs to be milled. It needs to go down to the base, and all the cracks need to be patched. And then you put 4 inches of asphalt on it and let it cure over the winter. It would be a major undertaking, but it would be, if it's done right. See, the last time it was just sealed. It wasn't really paved. A lot of people say, oh, the track was paved. It wasn't. They put this crap down around and they did it in the dark because they only got halfway through and the guy was going to come back the next day and Bob O'Rourke says, oh, turn the lights on.
I was there. I was working for Stanko out of Glen Cove.
All right.
I was there. I did the paving there. I made sure it was done right. I tried.
They didn't want to pay the right money. They wanted a Band-Aid job. It should have been milled, and it should have been 4 inches of asphalt.
You're right.
And the patches should have been, they should have been saw cut out, all those cracks, they should have been saw cut out, patched, and then milled. You would think I was in the paving business. I'm not even in the paving business, and I know how to pave a racetrack.
Yeah, definitely.
You know it would be 100 grand to do it right. It would be 100 grand. And the walls need to be fixed, and they need to be rebuilt. There's no rebar in those walls. That's why when the school buses back into them, they crack. I didn't plan to make the last 20 minutes to put down the place because I don't mean to put the place down. I'm not putting the place down. It's constructive criticism to make it better.
Yeah, you have to put money back into your investment. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
I wouldn't even have demolition there. I would have strictly stock car racing, and that's it.
You know. And
they're cool.
You know, my racers are saying they claim they spent $250,000 on the last paving job. Let me tell you something. I could, if you read my first two books, somewhere, and all my books are starting to blend now, somewhere in there was a little
story about a guy who put up the put the jersey barriers up to stop the sand from going into the driveway that had to be dug up, who put in drainage and all this kind of nonsense, and he did it for an exchange for tires. But the owners of the racetrack think they paid for it because they took cash out of the garbage bag and gave it to a person thinking it was earmarked for the guy who did the work. And they got raped on that. But whatever.
Like I said, other tracks do. Wall does improvements. Mountain does improvements. Mahoning Valley, you know, they all do upgrades and all that stuff. And like I said before, they pay. And like they're having those special races there, what they call it, the ace race or whatever. It's like a card game or whatever.
Yeah.
Where they pay so much to win. And if you keep winning, you keep earning more and more money, which is a good idea, too. You know, keep people interested in going. You know, that's why Hirschman runs there and Paulus and all those guys. That's why they gave up Mountain, went to Mahoning now, because Mahoning pays a little bit more.
Yeah. No, WJ saying it went elsewhere. It went from the office to the parking lot. That's where it went, WJ. And Harry Man, I know who Harry Man is, and Harry Man could vouch for some of the things that I'm saying. I don't make this crap up, and I'm not looking to put people down. I just tell it like it is, you know. But there's so many things, and even like with. When you do these some of these school bus things and whatnot, that, you spend money to pave a racetrack and then you tear it up by having a school bus demolition derby with getting all cut up and scratched and gouged and you know you, I don't know.
There's you one know. Other thing I'd love to see back out there is vintage modified racing.
It's got to be done.
Marty would like to see that, and I know Marty won't go out there because of what's going on, but. I'd eat my pride. I did. I'm back, you know, if they let me back in there, you know what I'm saying? But I'd love to see vintage. I can get the Garden State Vintage Club to come. I can get New England Antique Races, which is Star. I can get these clubs to come because I'm a member. They'll come. You know, they have to put a little money out to get them to come, but they'll come.
But you'll make it back.
Top cars that raced back in the day.
Yeah, you'll make it back. That's, you know, you got to spend. It's like any business. You gotta
have it on a Saturday night, not a Sunday afternoon with go-karts. You gotta have it on a Saturday night.
Oh yeah, I mean, the East End Karting Club, they do the little exhibition. They've been, you know, that started in the EKRA days. They'd come out and they'd put on a little exhibition with the things, but you know, it cost them nothing to do that. In fact, the parents that came to watch the races had to pay to get in, and you know, I think that was wrong too. But you know, who am I? You know, but you know, it's gonna take a lot to get Marty back then, and
see, I don't think we'll see that.
I don't think in our lifetime we'll see Marty Hines back at Riverhead Raceway.
Like I say, with the clubs, Joe, what happens is you give a donation to the Garden State Vintage Club, no matter, you know, say like $1,000 or whatever, that goes into your general kitty, and then what happens is the club gives you a couple of bucks to show up. You know what I'm saying? They take care of their members and stuff like that. I mean, they just had the banquet 2 weeks ago over in for the Garden State Vintage Club, and they honored Bob Punzi and the Fuentes, believe it or not.
Oh, wow.
He's in the Hall of Fame now, Bob Punzi, along with Tony Fuente Sr. and stuff, you know, for racing at Wall and stuff like that. So too bad there wasn't something we had on Long Island like that, a Hall of Fame for, you know, like Jazumbach would be there, you know, and you know, Baldwin would be in there, and you know, all the guys that ran, you know.
But you know, it's kind of funny because I know at the last Safer meeting, they had talked about bringing in one of the other classes here from Long Island into the club to make the club bigger, and my argument was, you know, what are you looking to gain from that? What is Safer, the Suffolk Association of Figure Eight Racing, going to gain by having blunderbuss guys draw, you know, join? So one of the guys says, well, we'll have more members. Okay, so now if you have more members, you're splitting your point fund now with two divisions, you're splitting your trophies, and oh no, they'll do their separate. Well, then they didn't have merging. And I said, it would be like the Sons of Italy merging with the Hibernians because they need new members. It doesn't work.
You know what I would like to see? Like the late models are going to run down at Wall. So why couldn't they have like a tri-track series like they used to do with the dirt modifies when they raced at Flemington, Orange County, and Nazareth? So why couldn't they do that for the late models and do it with the modifieds? Let the Mountain Speedway be involved, let freaking Wall Stadium be involved, and Rivet, and just go around the circuit, whatever. Three tracks, one from Jersey, one from PA, and one from New York, whatever.
Well, you know,
they could do it. They could definitely do it.
Hey, one of the things I'm trying to get going, and I planted the seed in a couple of people I think that have the power to make it happen, is take the legend cars and have X number of races on Long Island, X number of races at Waterford, and you call it the Cross Sound Challenge. You get a title sponsor for it, and your points count for both places, and boom. Whoever's the point leader at the end gets a nice chunk of change.
Yeah, it's a good idea.
And you know, for some reason, when I suggested it 10 years ago, I didn't know what I was talking about. But I think I got the seed planted in the right people to make that happen.
Well, why can't NELMA do that? I mean, you know, they run Mountain Speedway.
Absolutely.
Why can't they run Riverhead and then try to get Wall Stadium involved?
You know, it's kind of like years ago when the owners of Riverhead were promoting Islip and they needed the cars. When they bought Riverhead, they needed cars. So they made a Long Island point fund.
Yeah.
That you had to race both tracks to get in this point fund. You know? And what? Every man just said something that caught my eye. But if you do that, you know, well, why not? You do with the legends. You do, like with the late models, you do a thing with Mountain and Riverhead and the points count. Or you do, you know, there's so many things you could do to spur up interest, and that helps build your car count. Because now the late models are at, for argument's sake, are gonna say, whoa, I wanna get in that point thing. I want that big check at the end. I'm gonna go to Riverhead. And the Riverhead guys are gonna say, whoa, I gotta go to Mountain when we're off and get those points. And that's what they need to do. And I think what's happening, and I hope the powers to be from the Long Island Racetrack that listen to what I say every week so they can go and paraphrase it and get it all wrong. I think what they need to do is get a PR person in there that's truly a PR person that does stuff like this. I'm not saying that the guy that's doing it now isn't working hard, because he's working very hard. But what's happening is he's working too hard at keeping his job. You gotta be able to, you gotta step out of the box. You gotta make these things happen. And you can't be afraid of your boss being mad at you for trying something, because if your boss is mad at you for trying something, they're in the wrong business. Because that's
like Tracy at Bethel. She was here on Long Island.
Yeah,
she did. That's one of the best tracks. Even when we go up there with the vintage cars, they treat us good there, and we have to tow. Like my brother tows like 2 hours or whatever. It takes me like 3-4 hours to get up there, and they treat me good up there.
When I went there and I put money into their purse to bump it up a little bit. You would have thought who I was royalty when I walked around. I'm walking down the front stretch to go get something to eat, and the announcer, and here's Joe Austin from Long Island, and everybody's cheering and waving at me. I'm like, holy jeez, what did I do? I put $100 in your purse, $200, whatever it was. But that's what you do.
That's why any track I go to, I bring extra DVDs, and hey, let's have a track giveaway of Long Island Need for Speed. You know,
exactly,
so-and-so.
Exactly. You know, I go to Stafford, I give away books for free. I go to Thompson, I give away books for free. You know, whatever.
I'd like to see that.
But I can't do that here on Long Island. I was told not to do that.
It brings fans.
I can't even sell them. They didn't want me to sell my books in the Fed area. Because it's taken away from their concession stand. That's what I was told. And as Harry Man said before, they tried that once and it didn't work. That's what they told my publicist. But whatever. I don't know of anybody that tried to sell books there, but I guess they weren't getting a big cut.
Just like they should sell weekly videos at Riverhead Raceway. I'd be willing to do it, whatever. I know they have Captain Video, but sell them at the photo booth.
Exactly.
I mean, I did the 1 year for the vintage stuff. And that was just the money for, you know, the vintage stuff.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, we could go round and round, and until the ownership changes or until the PR people change, I don't think anything's going to change there. And again, the guy that does it now, he works very hard at what
he
does.
But he
needs to do it full time. It needs to be the full time thing that he does, and he needs to be paid accordingly. And they can't be afraid to step out of the box. You got to step out of the box. You got to try things. You know, and those cold May nights and June nights where you don't have a good crowd, Bring your report card. If you have an A, you're in for free. I don't care if it's your neighbor's report card that don't like racing, because it's going to get the father and the uncle or the mother or the aunt, whatever. It's going to get somebody from the family that has to take you there. You're going to get their $100 bill.
It's fireman's night, Joe. I can get the drill teams to go there. Believe it or not, they're out in Riverhead in August, running right down the block. I could have a fireman's drill team night or whatever, and they'd bring the tournament trucks and let them sit on the midway or whatever.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And, WJ, my racing just said Captain Video's recordings are missing key pieces edited. And I know that firsthand because the certain video that was sent down to NASCAR to penalize a certain competitor was missing 12 seconds, the key 12 seconds.
I think that's the reason why I got thrown out of the place, because I showed it on Long Island Jam. I showed somebody dumping somebody, and that's the way it was.
Oh, man. It was.
But I don't do that no more. I learned my lesson.
And Jerry Cook wanted to know why there was two different videos. I'll never forget that. And then and when the person who sent the full unedited version of the video down to Jerry Cook, and Jerry Cook called the racetrack screaming, that individual was black flagged for the next 3 weeks. And he was told, I guess you don't have the video to prove that I'm wrong. So it's stuff like that.
Like I said before, I used to show this stuff, and I guess that's what got me in trouble. But I learned my lesson, you know what I'm saying?
Hell yeah.
They have somebody videotaping there anyway, so he got the idea from
exactly.
Ricky Miller.
I'll tell you what, when I'm up in the Texas, when I go to Stafford Motor Speedway in Connecticut, and I call Mark Arute, I call Lisa Arute, hey, I'm coming, could I get on the list? Absolutely, boom, 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 I'm in the VIP list. I watch the races from the tower for the most part. Sitting there with their competition director, and he has a TV, because they broadcast everything, I believe, on New England Sportnet. And he has a TV, and he watches the stuff. And we were watching an incident, and I'll tell you what, from the naked eye, it looked one way, and then we watched the video, we watched the replay, and it was something else. But they utilized that, and maybe that should be utilized everywhere. I'm sure there's other racetracks that utilize that as well.
I think they do that at Riverhead now. They have the videotape in there all the time. They look at it through the little booth.
Yeah, but then they still go to a committee meeting to make the decision while the cars are circling around at 12 miles an hour for 20 minutes. One guy. There's one CEO. There's one president. There's one king. There's one crew chief. There's one CEO. You don't have three kings sitting in the throne room and making a decision about the kingdom. You have one, and that's.
Well, that's the guy, Pitbull. Me and Ricky Miller showed him everything. Believe it or not, he's the first around. Yeah. Yeah. Well, what are you gonna do? Gave away to all my trade secrets. What? I'm in the NASCAR Hall of Fame. He ain't.
Oh, God, that was a good one.
Well, it's true. Go push the button down there in freaking Daytona.
That's right. And I can vouch for that because I saw it.
See the thing on Richie Evans in my video.
There it is.
I got a plaque for it. Big deal. Betty got one, too.
Yeah. Oh, well, it's that time, Kevin. It's time to we're all good race fans hanging up for the night.
Just mention, if you're interested, on Saturday night, my firehouse is having a fundraiser. I know you like the bowl, the Bayshore Bowl at 9 o'clock. They're having a fundraiser. I mean, it's $25 a head. You get food and everything else.
North Lindy FD, right? North Lindy?
Yeah. It's for the fire medic company. Yeah.
All right.
Trying to get some stuff together for a new ambulance.
Unfortunately, believe it or not, I'm doing a family dinner. I'm turning 55.
Oh boy.
And actually on Monday is my actual birthday. I'll be 55, but we'll do like a family dinner. So I'm not gonna wear my black hat next Monday. I'm gonna wear like a birthday hat, like with a little rubber band, a little pointy thing, the little things that you blow when they open up and come back. I'm gonna have a little fun with next week's show. And next week's show we should tentatively scheduled is 2012 Riverhead Raceway Figure Eight Champion Mike Muse, who will be fresh here from getting his hardware at the Safer Awards Banquet, which is Sunday at the Smithtown Landing Country Club in Smithtown. From 4 to 8 p.m. All are welcome. That's $60 a head. And it's a good night.
Can I get it for free and film it?
So, oh well. Yes, WJ. But I'm still not as old as you, WJ. Because I'm still not as old as you. Anyway. All right, Kevin, thank you very much for your input, as always.
All right, thank you.
And thanks for calling. I appreciate it. Thanks a lot to everybody else that was in the chat room tonight. I see you picked up a little bit. We got a few people in there. I want to thank everybody for taking time out of their busy schedules to spend some time with us here at 505 on Racing Show here in Ravio. We'll be here next week, same time, 7 to 9. Well, I'll say 7:02 to 9:01 p.m. here at InRavio.com. And again, thank you, everybody. Hope everybody had a blessed holiday season, and I wish everybody safety in their endeavors. And whoever's going to Martinsville this weekend, have a safe trip. Enjoy. God bless you all, and we will see you next week. Have a good night.
I'm a maniac, and I'm on the attack, and you're a racetrack hack in the back of the pack. I drive like my Uncle Pete. He's blind and ain't got no feet. Just one more lap till I take the checker. Add another win to my winning record, another trophy, more respect. And a great big gosh darn check. See, there I am.